It is really a great pleasure to have our first solo speaker, Jan Ting, with us today. Jan, Professor Ting, to give him his due, is originally from Ann Arbor, Michigan, but he's been teaching law at Temple University for a number of years. And in 1990, he was appointed Assistant Commissioner of the Immigration and Naturalization Service, now known as ICE, by the first President Bush, and he served there for 3 years. In 2006, he ran unsuccessfully as a Republican candidate for the U.S. Senate in Delaware, a real act of courage in a very blue state. But today, however, like many of us, Jan is a political independent. Jan, we're very pleased to have you. Welcome to the Writer's Workshop.
Thank you. Well, it's great to be here and great to follow such wonderful presentations this morning. I look forward to the full day's presentations. It was fascinating to hear John Tanton's entry into the immigration issue through conservation, and I'm sure everyone here has a story on how they became involved with this particular issue. Just like everyone has an interesting immigration story in your family, everyone has an interesting story about how they came to this movement. I was a tax lawyer, right? How did I end up involved in immigration? I was practicing tax law. I was teaching exclusively tax law. You know who else was a tax lawyer? Clarence Thomas, the Supreme Court Justice, was a tax lawyer. And when President Reagan was inaugurated, he was working as a tax lawyer for the Monsanto Corporation in Missouri. He was. He tells the story himself. And his friend John Danforth said to him, "Hey, you know this new administration in Washington? You should go to Washington and get yourself a job in this new administration." And Clarence Thomas says, "How would I do that?" And John Danforth, who happened to be a United States Senator from Missouri, said, "Oh, I'll make you an appointment at the White House." So Clarence Thomas is going to the White House, Office of Presidential Personnel, and he's thinking to himself, "I'm a tax lawyer, you know. Maybe they'll offer me a job at IRS or tax section of justice or something like that." So he goes in and meets the people. They look at Clarence Thomas and they say, "Civil rights. Can you do civil rights?" And Clarence Thomas says, "Well, sure, I'm a lawyer, you know, lawyers can do anything," right? So his first job is Assistant Secretary of Education for Civil Rights. He spends 1 year there, goes on the EEOC, becomes chairman, spends 1 year on the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, Supreme Court. So that's his path to Washington. Well, you know, when the Bush administration came in, I had people saying to me, "You should go to Washington, get a job with this new administration." And I said, no, I've got kids, you know, it's not the right time. And they said, "You know what, there's never a right time. And this would be good for you, it'd be good for your career, you should do it. And we can make you an appointment at the White House." So I said, "Oh, okay, well, I guess I'll go in and talk to them." So I'm thinking, you know, well, I'm a tax lawyer. I do exclusively tax law, and I teach tax law. That's all I teach, nothing but tax law. And so I'm thinking, you know, I'll get a tax job maybe. And of course, I go in and they look at me and say, immigration. "Can you do immigration?" And I say, "Well, you know, I'm a lawyer, right? Lawyers can do anything. So I guess I can do immigration." Next thing I know, I'm the Assistant Commissioner of the Immigration and Naturalization Service, which turned out to be a terrific job, you know. I mean, I just learned so much. I was in at headquarters. I was in the midst of everything that was going on in immigration, and I was really thrown into the immigration debate and having to decide from day one, where do you stand on all these issues? And it wasn't just, you know, outside the Beltway, people say, "Oh, these battles are always between the administration and their, you know, outside critics." But if you live in the Beltway, you know the real battles go on within the administration, right? People fighting among themselves. And within the Bush administration, I mean, I was regularly harassed by people in the administration who are saying, well, how many poor Mexicans did you deport today, you know? As though, you know, we were like the bad guys or something like that. And it did force you to decide. As I think at that time, everyone who worked for INS had a clear answer to the question of whether it was morally right to enforce immigration laws in the United States or not. I mean, in those days, people had other alternatives for work. If you didn't come to the conclusion that it was morally enforceable in a democracy to enforce that democracy's laws on immigration, you shouldn't be working there, right? And I think all the people there at that time agreed with that. And there were a lot of policy disputes within the administration. And obviously, the Bush administration was responsible for the 1990 Immigration Act that John Miano has pointed out as one of the turning points for the worse, I think, in our immigration policy. So it was a mixed bag. But I think the people at INS in those days were all committed to faithfully enforcing the laws of the United States. As written, whether we agreed with them or not, we were going to faithfully enforce the laws. And that was always a question. What does the law require us to do? And I think people tried to do that. When my time in Washington ended in 1993, because President Bush was not reelected, I did stay through the transition. I'll just tell one story about the transition, and that is, the Clinton team had come in, and we were trying to teach them, and remember at the end, during the Bush administration, we were handling all these refugee issues, like the people were coming out of Haiti in large numbers on boats, and we were trying to process them at sea, we actually opened up the Guantanamo naval base. the first use of Guantanamo as a detention facility was by INS, because we had to find a place to detain all the Haitians and eventually Cubans who were coming out in large numbers. But we tried to, but those facilities were filled to capacity. And at some point in the Bush administration, at the highest level, the president himself decided that we could no longer continue this refugee processing at sea. And he decided that, you know, from now on, we're going to try and intercept the people coming to the United States by boat, and we're going to turn them around and bring them back to wherever they came from. And we didn't have the capability to process them at sea anymore. And so we couldn't take them to Guantanamo, and so we're just going to repatriate them automatically. And this was kind of, as the campaign got going, President Clinton was attacking this policy as inhumane, you know, and promising that one of the things that he would do if he was elected was change our refugee policy and you know, find a way to treat all these people fairly rather than just repatriating them back to Haiti. That was a campaign issue. Some of you may remember it was a big issue in the campaign. And of course, Clinton won, and so his transition team is in there with us, and we're sharing with them showing what's happening in Haiti as Inauguration Day approaches. What do you think was happening? People were building boats. Lots of boats were being assembled in Haiti, getting ready for Inauguration Day, and all the folks were going to head out for the United States, which highlights the point that the message is important. The message that we deliver to the rest of the world, you know, I'm just jumping all over my speech here, but who was it? One of my colleagues at Temple, some of you may know who it is, used to say, the poor people of the world may be poor, but they're not stupid. He used to say, they're as capable as anyone in this room, he used to say, at using cost-benefit analysis to decide what's in their own best interest. And just like us, they do it all the time. They do it all the time. So if you want more illegal immigration, all you have to do is send a signal that we're going to lower the cost of illegal immigration and we're going to raise the benefits, you will get more. And conversely, if you want less illegal immigration, you have to raise the costs and lower the benefits, and you will get less. It's just the basic law of economics. So what had happened in the transition was they could see, the satellite photography showed, we're going to be a huge outflow of people from Haiti coming to the United States. And they made us run through all the alternatives. You know, is there an island in the sun that we can use? Can we use aircraft carriers? Can we, you know, every possibility that we had already thought of and exhausted. And on the eve of the inauguration, the incoming administration announces they're going to leave that policy in place, having attacked it all through the campaign and made it a campaign issue. They're going to leave that policy in place. And indeed, they defended that policy for a longer period of time in the Clinton administration than we had defended it in the Bush administration. It became more of a Clinton policy than a Bush policy, and they had to defend the policy in court because it was challenged by all these advocacy groups. And so they went all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States and won a historic 8-1 victory, where the Supreme Court said, yes, you can do that, that we're not bound by international convention that applies on the high seas when you're rescuing people and trying to save their lives. 8-1, a Supreme Court, a historic Supreme Court victory. And remember, at the start of the Clinton administration, they had all this trouble finding an attorney general, and you can't appoint a commissioner of the INS until you have an attorney general, and so there were all these appointments that were late. And so the acting commissioner of the INS was a civil servant. They didn't have a political appointee in there. And so when this historic victory was won by the Clinton administration defending the Bush administration's policy, the name on the Supreme Court case was a civil servant, Chris Sale, and who I knew. And so I called her up and I said, Chris, you're famous. You know, this case will go down in history with your name on it, this historic Supreme Court victory, this clarification of the law applying to refugees on the high seas. Well, how about if I talk about my 06 Senate campaign? So, you know, when I moved to Delaware, I was well aware of the fact that Delaware's a tiny state. It's one congressional district, but it has two United States senators. And so I thought, boy, if I ever had a chance to run for the United States Senate, why would I not do that? Because it's so small, you can sleep in your own bed every night. I thought maybe you don't even have to raise as much money as you'd have to raise for a Senate run in any other state. And so anyway, you know, in 2006, lo and behold, the Republicans didn't have a candidate for the United States Senate. And so they came to me and said, hey, would you like to take a shot at this? By this time, I was kind of interested in immigration. I said, you know what, I'd like to talk about immigration because I think it's an issue that people are not paying attention to, and so I would run if I can focus my campaign on immigration and talk about it. And you know, I did my best. It turns out I'm not very good at raising money. But my big endorsement, to my surprise, was a fraternal order of police. Delaware, as you know, is a very blue state, and the Democrats are very entrenched. And then, all the people you'd think would be on our side or actually on their side. But I went to the convention of the Fraternal Order of Police. I knew no one in the organization. I didn't have an insider who was feeding me, you know, punchlines or things I should talk about. I just went in there and talked about immigration. And I said, you men and women know, I remember it's just like this room, you men and women know that innocent Delawareans are dying on the highways in traffic accidents caused by people who are unlicensed, undocumented, and uninsured. And you know it's happening all the time, and the media won't cover it. You know that our little state is confronting gang violence that's caused by immigration, and the media won't cover it. And the one thing I can promise you is if I'm elected to the United States Senate, this is going to be known. What you know is going to be known by everyone in this state. So I didn't think, you do a lot of these talks when you're running for office, I didn't think much about it, but I was surprised shortly thereafter to read that the Fraternal Order of Police had voted to endorse me, an unknown, when they had previously endorsed my opponent when he had run the first time, a former governor. So that was the high point of my campaign for the United States Senate, getting that victory. Let me just say one thing about the current president, and that is I supported Obama in 08. Why did I do that? I was out of office. I was a private citizen. I thought I could do whatever I wanted. And I also thought that, and I was saying to people, I'll support any Republican except John McCain. Because John McCain had such a terrible immigration policy, which was identical to Obama's, by the way, supporting the big amnesty. And I said, I can't support John McCain. And I actually think John McCain would be worse than Obama. He would be worse in the sense that a President McCain could twist enough Republican arms to get the vote to get the amnesty through. And I didn't think that Obama could do that. And for the first term, I was patting myself on the back and saying I was right, you know, that Republicans would unify to block Obama's big amnesty. But if McCain had gotten in, he would have gotten the big amnesty through. The country would be down the drain already. There wouldn't be a fight to fight anymore. So I was patting myself on the back, feeling pretty good. I hadn't counted on the executive orders, you know, the president saying, I can't get it through Congress, but you know what? I don't need Congress. I'll just do it by myself. So that, I admit, took me by surprise. So let me just, I've still got a green light. Okay, good. Good. So I got a few more points that I'll just make, that emphasizing some of the points that others have made. I don't think we should vilify immigration or immigrants, even illegals. The point being, you know, if we were in their shoes, maybe we'd do the same thing. People behave rationally under the circumstances, but that doesn't absolve us of having to decide what's best for the country. We still have that burden. And I think, as John Tanton said, you know, we all admire and respect immigrants. Of course, we do. We're all descendants of ancestors that came here from somewhere else. Everyone's got an immigration story in their family somewhere. But we still have to make a choice, and it's the choice that John Tanton said. Given the fact that we admire and respect immigrants, how many are we going to take every year? And to me, that's a binary choice. The binary choice is, are we going to let every single person in the world who wants to come to the United States take their shot at the American dream? Or alternatively, are we going to enforce some sort of limit on immigration? That's what it boils down to, a binary choice. And one or the other. And you know, people say, well, we can't have unlimited numbers. That's politically untenable, right? As people on the other side always say, well, nobody's for that. Well, okay, then are you for enforcing a limit of some kind? Well, not if it means turning away people that aren't criminals, you know, people that remind us of our own ancestors. So you're not for that either. You're not for either of the binary choices. And people say, well, yeah, those are too hard. Give me a third choice. And here's the third choice that has evolved, right? The third choice is, let's pretend we have an immigration limit, but let's not enforce it. How's that sound? People say, yeah, that's okay. You know, they want the third choice, which is let's pretend we have immigration limits. All the laws are left on the books. We just don't enforce them. And that seems to be the direction that we go in. We can't fall for their false dichotomy that, well, the alternative is you've got to deport all 11 million people that are here illegally. That is a false, that is a straw man. And as my colleague Mark Krikorian has written and many others have said, the goal is simply attrition, right? Through the managing of costs and benefits, we need to get the numbers of illegal immigrants in the United States going down every year, down, 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 down. You'll never hit zero, and that's not the goal. The goal is to send a message. You know, perception, as we all know, is actually more important than reality. It's important to send that message in this age of instant communications, where people can find out, where illegals thinking about coming to the United States know better than the United States government what's actually happening at the border, because they're talking to people there all the time. We need to send the message that there's consistent, even-handed enforcement across the board, the maximum extent of our resources. We're going to enforce the law. Our goal is not to deport every single illegal. Our goal is to get the number of illegals steadily going down year after year after year in a way that everyone can see it. And so the message is understood all over the world. If you're thinking about coming to the United States illegally, think again, because the U.S. is at work enforcing the law. I think the role of cultural assimilation is an important one. I think both United States citizens in the naturalization process and legal permanent residents, when they get their green cards, should pledge in advance to their commitment to assimilate into the culture of the United States. And they should pledge, you know, certain things that we would try and agree on, that the equality of all individuals, the equality of men and women, the right of people to choose their own marriage partners. And if it turns out that they don't actually adhere to those pledges, then we revoke their citizenship or revoke their green cards. There's actually precedent for that in the immigration laws, that, you know, if you pledge to do something and you lie about it, then I think that's grounds for revoking whatever benefits you receive. And I think we need to think about you know, enforcing a commitment to assimilation. The United States is and can be, should be, a multi-ethnic society, but it shouldn't be a multicultural society. You need to have one culture, and I think everyone can contribute to that, but it needs to be one common culture. Just one of my reminiscences about growing up in Michigan, I spent 1 year in the Detroit public school system in second grade, and my recollection about that was, in second grade in Detroit, Michigan, we sang patriotic songs in school, right? We not only took the Pledge of Allegiance every day, but we sang, and we knew where the halls of Montezuma were and the shores of Tripoli. We knew what a caisson was as they go rolling along. So through patriotic songs, you not only learn history, but you develop a sense of identity with the Republic. And I think that was a good experience. It stayed with me, and I'm sure stayed with all the people that were in second grade in my class. I don't know whether it was a teacher or the school board or what at that time, but we sang patriotic songs in school. That was a good experience. And the last, well, a couple last points, since I still have time, that, you know, I wrote a piece on Muslim exclusion when that became an issue in the current campaign. And we all need to understand that, you know, there was this outrage flowing that that would be unconstitutional to exclude anyone on the basis of their religion. And I wrote a piece in the Philadelphia Inquirer and said, you know, not really. That would not be an issue. That there's, as some of you know who've studied immigration, that there's well-established rules that the political branches can exclude anyone. It's not like people in the United States who have rights. These are people outside the United States who want to come to the United States, and it's well-established in the law that the political branches can use whatever criteria they want in excluding people, even race. You know, I'm well aware of the fact that the first immigration laws in the United States were Chinese exclusion laws, keeping Chinese outside the United States. I think that was a bad policy choice. a bad policy choice. But it's not, that's a different question than whether the government should have the power to make bad policy choices or not. And I think it's important for the government to have a broad range of policy choices, even if the government sometimes makes mistakes, which we all know it does. And actually, Congress has addressed this specific question about whether the president can exclude on any basis in a section called 212F of the Immigration and Nationalities Act. And in 212F, Congress says the president is authorized to exclude anyone or any group if the president decides it's not in the best interest of the country to admit them. So I think there's no question of the constitutionality. And so I said, you know, it boils down to a policy choice. It's not a question of constitutionality. And I was reminded of, there's an ad on TV for WeBuyAnyCar.com. I don't know if you've seen that, but it has a little line that says, WeBuyAnyCar.com, any. And I use that to emphasize when the statute says you can exclude any individual or any group, it means any. So it's well established in the law. The last point I'll make is that I am, in fact, still a registered Republican, notwithstanding my expulsion from the Republican Party for supporting Obama in 08. And I'm actually not a resident of Delaware anymore, as it says in the biography. In 2014, I moved to Pennsylvania, a swing state. So, thank you very much.
Do you want to take some questions?
Yeah. All right, I'll take some questions. Speak up, please. Sure. I mean, anyone who obtains citizenship by misleading the U.S. government, and they have to fill out extensive forms, and if they don't make all the required disclosures, they should have their citizenship revoked. The larger picture is what has been going on in the administration. They have been pushing to naturalize as many people as possible before the election. That's what it's all about. And so they've been going out there and rounding up everyone who has had a green card for the requisite period of time and trying to get them naturalized, trying to get them registered to vote in the hopes that that's going to be a critical margin of victory. So that's what's really going on. That's what's most objectionable. Not just that they've made some glaring mistakes that need to be corrected, but the underlying policy has been to push for naturalization without the required vetting, which raises questions about this administration's capacity to vet that they claim.
Yeah, there's
no question there's a big push on to naturalize people in anticipation of the election. So, you know, that's bad. But it's hard to denaturalize people once they've gotten their citizenship. It does require going to federal court and getting their citizenship revoked. I will say that a lot of American citizens, surprisingly, don't speak English. Puerto Ricans are American citizens, right? And so a lot of them grow up not speaking English, but they're American citizens from birth. There actually is part of the naturalization law that, you know, there's an English language requirement, which is so minimal for naturalization, but it's in there. But even that is waived in the case of people age, you know, what's it called, 50, age 50 and over, and have been in here 15 years or
20 years.
So, I mean, the theory as well, if you're over 50 and you've been here for 20 years and you haven't learned English, it's hopeless. So we might as well give you citizenship anyway without even having to meet that minimal English language requirement. So people are getting naturalized without knowing English. And I'll also say one day I was flying into JFK from overseas somewhere, and I was amused to see that all the immigration inspectors were Asians, right, wearing our uniform. And I'll just one other story. When one of the interesting cases we dealt with at INS when I was there was, there was a Cambodian dance troupe, like the first dance troupe that came from communist Cambodia into the United States. And the Cambodian exile community was saying, oh, they all want to defect. But they can't defect because they're being controlled by their commissars or something. And so we were under a lot of pressure to say, well, you need to interview these. We had exit controls, so they can't leave the country, but you know, you need to talk to them. Well, whose translator do we use? So the exile community said, oh, we'll provide the translators, you know, and the Cambodian communist government said, no, we'll provide the translators, you know. And so there's a big fight as to whose translators we're going to use to talk to the people. And it turned out we had Cambodian Americans immigration officers on our staff. So, oh, we got this covered. You know, we're going to use our own sworn immigration officer who happened to be Cambodian immigrants to conduct the interviews and make a determination on that basis whether we're going to let the people leave or not. So there's some virtue in having these language skills in your ranks of the Immigration Service.